So you said you grew up, born and bred in New York.
Yeah.
So walk us through what it's like being a New Yorkian. What are you, Yankees, New Yorkians?
Yeah. I just say Brooklynite.
All right, walk us through being a Brooklynite.
Well, it's on edge. It's a fast, like it's portrayed to be a fast life. It's rugged, it's tough, it's grimy, it's expensive. Brooklyn is one of the most expensive places in the market right now. I think, I know. Gentrification is really heavy in Brooklyn right now. But Brooklyn, one thing I could say definitely is culture. So much culture. You could see a Biggie mule just on the wall. Is it mule?
Mural. I think. Is it mule?
Yeah, there you go. My bad. Shout out.
We can edit.
But you can see that anywhere. You can see Duck Down. You can see Wu-Tang on the walls, like graffiti. Like, that's the type of city it is. Trains, graffitied on and stuff like that. It's really like that in New York. And then it's just like, New York is the kind of thing, it's like two sides. New York could be really beautiful or could be really messed up. Like, you could come from Williamsburg and have nice plants, trees, and bikes, and tea. And then you could have a side where it's crackheads and drugs and robbing and gangs and regular stuff, like, you know, it's just the fact that the difference between the two is basically what life you try to choose. Because it's like, when I was on Parkside, it was either I was gonna be a gangbanger or I was gonna die, or
those were your options.
Yeah, that's basically it. But in that aspect, I had older people who told me that this just ain't the way, because there's a lot of people that's misguided, like people who don't have no clue in what is what and don't know because life is just too big, you know? Because sometimes you can't help anybody from feeling like that. Life is a very big thing. At the end of the day, I feel like I passed the average statistic in Brooklyn at the age of 20, and most of my friends haven't.
Right.
Most of my friends are still chasing the dream that is portrayed by something that is impossible to get. You know what I'm saying? Which I feel like is just endlessly in a rat race to find yourself in the situation that you didn't follow what you wanted to do.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Brooklyn, like I said, being on Parkside, that's where I'm from. I had older homies that told me things like, well, one of my older homies, he died, R.I.P. Stunner one time. He was the one who told me, there is no reason for you to be talented and to be in a gang. That doesn't make any sense. You're a smart kid. Like, I'm not saying I had the interest of being in a gang. It's just things that are around you. You know what I'm saying? So I listened to his advice. I think that was one of the changing points in my life, because I just was like, you know, at the end of the day, I was doing delinquent things. But, you know, in that aspect, he told me, he was like, yo, at the end of the day, you can either be here like me, or you can make something of yourself and be something to everybody.
Right.
So he was like, I see you really like this music stuff. I hear it, because we used to live on the same floor. If it wasn't the same floor, then it was the fourth floor. So you could hear my music. A lot of people on my floor heard my music. Like, they were like hearing, like, oh, who is that kid? He's always making beats and that, da, 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 this, at the 30. They know. But yeah, he told me, he's like, yo, you got to make a choice. At the end of the day, I can't make that choice for you. It's a choice that everybody has to make, because people make that choice. Nobody's stupid. Mm-hmm. Unless, like, you're mentally, like, and you know what I'm saying? Like, a lot of people aren't stupid. A lot of people know what they're doing and then want to fall back at the fact that they chose the wrong path is the reason why they failed. No, it's just that you didn't think about it. You didn't think about What was the longevity in what I'm about to do?
Mm-hmm.
Like, at the end of the day, when I thought about doing music, there was so much longevity that it was just like, why not do this? I'm not gonna find the longevity in the 9-to-5. I was a really good chemistry student. Like, I love chemistry. I had a 95 on the Regents. Chemistry is one of my favorite subjects. Was. It's been hectic since I was in school, but, like, you know, back then, I was really on my chemistry. So I was thinking, I'm like, yo, what do I really love, man? Music, chemistry, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
And I really thought about it, like, all right, if I was to do chemistry, what? I love the like, what chemistry is, exploring new heights, right? So this is why if you put A and B together, it gets C. Why does it get C? Then you try to figure out the hypothesis, whatever, this, that, the third, right? So in that aspect, I was like, do I really want to always explore and explain the unknown or explore and be the unknown?
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So I was just like, you know what? Music sounds like the better choice. I was like, you know what? This is definitely longevity for me. And then on top of that, it's giving me musical skill. It's giving me rhythm. And rhythm is translated through all types of life. You want to know why? Because rhythm is something of a loose type of, like, original sound. Like, for example, slang has rhythm.
Right.
Like, when I say A-O-B, that's rhythm. Mm-hmm. Because of the fact that that's something you're going to hear, and I immediately identify what that means without me even saying, hey, what's going on? Like, you get what I'm saying? It's a rhythm at the end of the day. Like, rhythms play a big part in life in general. So it's like, music would give me all types of skills, people skills. I could talk to people. I perform for people. I'm not weird against people because I'm with people all the time. Mm-hmm. Fashion, because what does rappers do on their off day? They get fly. Mm-hmm. So, okay, dress up and be me. Then it also gave me the skill of not being afraid to express myself, because a lot of people can't express themselves because of the situation in which they're in. So they feel like, okay, because I know this and that, the third is going to judge me, I'm not going to do this, even though I really want to. And just the fact that people have that ultimatum, I feel like that's just digressing your progress in
life.
You know what I'm saying? Like, it's just gonna, you're always going to feel restricted. You're always going to feel like chains is on you. You're never going to feel like you're free. Like, this is why a lot of songs would talk about, or like a lot of artists would talk about finally being free. Like, you know what I'm saying? Finally being free to say whatever you want, and it's still validated as a good opinion no matter what. Like, you know what I'm saying? At the end of the day, if anybody's seen Kid Cudi's TED Talk, at the end of the day, where Kid Cudi came from, to him, for him to do a TED Talk in his own city and to be respected on a level higher than all his peers, mm-hmm. that's amazing. That is like, amazing. You know what I'm saying? Definitely. At the end of the day, like, I could have been dead. I could have been in jail. I could have been gangbanging. Like, I could have been doing so much other things, but now I have a voice for kids that can't speak for themselves.
So do you find that you use your chemistry formula of taking A and B and making C, or the unknown, and applying that to your music? Because isn't that what you're doing with music?
That's what I do in music all the time. That's why Late Night Specials have so much different type of elements and things going on with it. Like, I just wanted to make it known. My whole point of Late Night Specials is to break the genre that people have on Pro Era in general. Because at the end of the day, Pro Era is a collective of many sounds. There's a lot of artists that have different sounding stuff, mm-hmm. but can't put it out because of the pre-existing label of what we are.
Right.
Like, yo, to be honest with you, I could do boom bap all day. It's in my blood. I could do it right now. It's not hard for me to do.
Anyone got two pens? Or?
And like, if anybody really has two pens and really want to see it, I could do it right now. I'm so serious. It's not a joke. Not a test. But, yeah, like, I wanted to create a self-relief, like a self-relief for the group, that they don't have to stick to like just doing what Joey broke out on. Like, right. You can do whatever you want. It's just how you do it, and you have to stay true of what the message initially is. Like, people can hear something and just not like it because of the beat. Today in hip-hop, 95% of music is just the beat. Mm-hmm. It ain't even the lyrics no more, truth be told. Let me think of a song that's like that. Well, actually, I'm not going to say that because it's throwing shade. Cause I thought about like 18 songs in my head just now. I was like, wow, that's throwing shade as hell. So let me not even say that. But like, a lot of music nowadays is just beat. It ain't even really the lyrics. Who really, really listen to the lyrics nowadays? Come on, unless you listen to J. Cole, Kendrick. Rick Ross can rap. That's the thing. People don't understand that. Rick Ross could really rap.
He got flows.
He does have flows. But does he have that lyrical content? Like, I listen to a Rick Ross song and I like it.
You
want to
know what
it
is?
But
you know what I could say? And this is not throwing shade, but this is just my mentality on it. I feel like it's scenery.
Okay.
Like rap. Like, I can envision everything Rick Ross is saying.
Yeah, 100%.
And that's fire, because that is an art form of rap.
100%.
Some people can't do that. Like, for example, Slick Rick story told for years, bro. Mm-hmm. He was telling stories. He had no bars, no double entendres. Stories. And he's just like, oh, yeah, back in the day. Oh, yeah, okay, back in the day. Now I'm back in the day. Like, it's all different types of, like, it's all different types of music. That's what I'm trying to show to people. Like, it don't have to be one thing. Like, we're in a generation where there's so much artists crossing over, doing other stuff. EDM linking with hip-hop, hip-hop festivals with EDM. Like, possibilities endless. It's just what you choose to talk about. You can rap on any beat. It's just what you choose to talk about. I could rap on the same beat. It could be two versions. Me talking about how much money I have, or talk about how much money I invest in creating a bigger whatever, dot, dot, dot. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's two different type of ways you can do it. It all depends on what you choose to say. And some people want to choose to listen to garbage. Mm-hmm. Some people don't want to listen to, like, oh, that there's global warming and there's gentrification and there's a fact that, think about it like this. I don't know if this is true, but I remember me and my, because I like to just talk about random things with the homies, theories, stuff like that. It's fun. Mm-hmm. Basically, what one of my mans was saying was basically how, I think it was my father and my friend, like how, think about it like this. In New York, there's a Chinatown or a Korean town, right? Something like that. Right?
Right.
Is there one here?
Yes, in West End, Central London, just Chinatown.
You get what I'm saying? They always have their own community in communities. They're to the culture. That and Jewish people. Mm-hmm. Fact.
Yeah.
Big fact. Yeah. Why don't black people have that? Like, why don't people of melanin have that? Why can't we do that? Mm-hmm. What is stopping us? There's all these type of different distractions, like in terms of, I don't know, like jealousy, emotions of just pure things that's not to the objective of being together as a nation.
Do you think it's the mentality that black people as a community have kind of been pushed towards with black history and stuff like that?
Yeah, at the end of the day, they put our people in projects, bro. That forces you to be a savage.
Right.
Yo, I walked in a couple of projects. Like, I know how, like, it literally is the smallest, like, it's like a jail cell, like, but it's for people that don't have the money to live better. Mm-hmm. And it's just, like, the fact that that's the norm, if you don't have money, then it's just, like, what's the point? Like, there's no helping, nothing. Like, at the end of the day, in Korea, Chinatown, whatever, they have businesses to fall back on because everybody's going there to buy it. Mm-hmm. Fish, something that they got, you want. Like, mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's always job opportunities. Our people don't even get discouraged so fast that it's just like, after a while, they're just like, what's the point of trying to find a job? Let me blame it on somebody else instead of myself. Like, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. I'm the type of person, I blame everything on myself. Like, if it ain't done right, then it's my fault. Mm-hmm. Because I let it happen. You feel what I'm saying? And I put all that stress on me, and I feel like that's what makes me. Wow. And me to become a better person, me to be more on point with things, me to understand how life works. You're not gonna understand life if you keep blaming other people, because then whose fault is it? Mm-hmm. Like, it's like if, oh, I didn't do my homework because of TV. Like,
mm-hmm. Well, no, it's not the TV's fault.
Like, it's not the TV's fault. It's your fault because you watch the TV. Mm-hmm. Like, that's the point. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, a lot of people don't really like to put it on themselves or admit to things. A lot of miscommunication is, like, one of the main stems, because it's, like, you have to simplify it. You have to simplify the complex. Mm-hmm. So miscommunication can mean a million things. But at the end of the day, the point is miscommunication. Right. Like, you could be like, I thought the party was so-and-so. Miscommunication, because you missed the event.
Right.
I thought you said you missed out, because it's miscommunication. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, it's come to the time where it's like you have to simplify everything for people to get the complexity of what you're trying to say.
And just strip it all the way back. Yeah. Wicked, picking up some real gems here tonight. So you did touch on gentrification.
Yeah.
I can't say the word gentrification. There you go. Yeah. In New York, we have something quite similar happening in the UK. We briefly spoke about a little bit earlier. And I'm from an area called Hackney in East London.
Yeah, I
grew up there.
Yeah.
And I feel like it's changing so much from when I was born and raised to now, because I feel like the communities are being pushed out, mm-hmm. and they've got all these new builds, as lovely as they are, and like new, like indie, trendy areas, yeah. which are, again, are great, but are taken away from what the area was, barring like crime and, you know, all of those things, but just taken away from the feeling of community.
Yeah.
How do you feel like that affects people in New York or people from the community that you're from?
Well, it affects the community a lot, because then it's just like, think about it like this. One person walk out is a hood dude.
Mm-hmm.
Another person walk out is a white person with a dog. Not saying it in terms of white or a black thing,
mm-hmm.
but it's just that the mixing pot of so many different cultures in one area, you don't know if it's good or not.
Yeah.
That's what the new thing about gentrification. All these personalities, does it work in this community? Like, in terms of, you can have people from everywhere, because at the end of the day, it's who wouldn't want to live in a new building that was just renovated?
Mm-hmm.
Like, who wouldn't? You could get anybody. And that's the scary thing about gentrification. It's just like, they're paying people to move out, to break it down, to sell it for more,
mm-hmm.
for people that can't afford it, one, and two, to jet people coming from outside of the country that don't even know, like, oh, it was cheaper than this.
Mm-hmm.
Like, at the end of the day, my mom always tell me the story, like, about how it used to be like $500, $800 for rent.
Wow.
Now renting a building in Brooklyn is like $2,000, $3,000,
wow.
$4,000 in that aspect. Brownstones, forget about it. It don't even make no sense. Like, it's just like, and it's discouraging, because it's just like, you can't find a place to live.
Mm-hmm.
That's the most discouraging thing I would ever think to have a problem with in my life.
Yeah.
There was a point where I had that thought where it was like, wow, I can't find a place to live because it's expensive as hell, and they just want everything I got.
Right.
Like, you know, you ever felt like that? Yeah. I feel like that all the time. I walk around and feel like that. I'll be like, dang, every time you want everything I got.
Mm-hmm.
Every time I go outside, like, you know what I'm saying? Me being Kirk Knight and me being me in real life is two different things.
Okay.
Musician-wise, happy dream. Life-wise, it affects the music, but music doesn't affect the life.
Okay.
Only financially.
Okay.
Feel me?